Thank you, Sarah. Good to be with you again. So, as you say, Sarah, so Galliford Try is a national contractor. We build the UK's social and economic infrastructure, schools, roads, water infrastructure. And this evening, I want to cover really three things. First, an overview of how we operate as a business. Secondly, just a review of the results and trading through to our June 2022 year end, and then a focus on our strategy and outlook. So the slide on the screen here really shows our philosophy for how Galliford Try operates. We call this our engine for sustainable growth, and we believe in the sense that all good construction companies would follow this type of virtuous circle. So it starts with the people, high quality people at the center of everything that we do. And then if you just start on the left hand side there, we have a strong culture of discipline, of risk awareness. This is about making sure that we take on profitable work with good clients. And the key for our business is that contract selectivity, and that's driven by the culture of risk awareness, which is homogenous across the business. That in turn leads to a really high quality order book with good embedded margins, good cash flow. And that order book is largely run with repeat clients. 94% is with repeat clients, and also through long-term frameworks. And moving to the right, those long-term frameworks give us really good visibility of the pipeline of future work. That means that we're able to plan the business, get our resources in line, make sure we're able to really plan for what our clients are looking for over the next 2 or 3 years. And of course, in turn, that means that we can deliver strong, profitable contracts with good cash flow to help strengthen the balance sheet. And I'll come on to the balance sheet later on. And in turn, that strong balance sheet reinforces the culture of discipline, of contract selectivity. And so the cycle turns again. So that's the philosophy that's really driving the business. And we're starting to see that coming through in the performance of the business now, as I'll come on to. So we're at June year end. So the numbers on the screen there for the financial year through to June 2022. And you can see it was a really excellent year. Thanks first and foremost to our people, to our supply chain, to our clients, of course. And you can see on the right-hand side that all the key metrics in the year have shown improvement. And as well as that, we've also had two very good acquisitions, one in October of 2021 and one in July of 2022. So again, I'll touch on those later on. But in general, this shows great progress against the strategy that we set out this time last year. We're on track to deliver our financial targets because we've got those right foundations, that right culture in the business, and the market outlook remains very, very good for the markets that we operate in. You can see on the right-hand side that in the year through to June 2022, our revenue was up 10%. More importantly than that, our divisional margin was up 40 basis points to 2.4%. And that's as a result of the quality of contracts coming through the order book starting to impact the results that we're now reporting, as well as investment in better contract delivery. That resulted in pre-exceptional profit before tax of £19.1 million, which is 68% up on last year. And that translates into strong earnings per share and dividend per share. Earnings per share up 68%, dividend per share up 70% on last year. And the exceptional items that I refer to, those are about investments in the business, one about an acquisition of a new business that we took out of administration. And the second is investment in digital infrastructure for the business to really support our growth as we go forward. So there's no contract performance, no adverse contract issues at all below the line, or indeed within the results as well. And those strong results, of course, were delivered in an inflationary environment. So inflation, as you know, started to spike about this time last year. And we've been able to mitigate and manage the impact of that inflation in exactly the way that we said we would when we set our strategy this time last year. You can see in those results that inflation hasn't had an adverse impact at all. Our balance sheet, Sarah referred to, remains very, very strong and very resilient. So we had average month-end cash of £174 million in the year to June. And that combined with our PPP assets of £48 million gave us a £221 million of assets on an average basis through last year. We've got no debt, we've got no defined benefit pension schemes. And this strong balance sheet is a real differentiator for our clients and for our supply chain. We now pay our supply chain on average in 25 days. So a really strong performance working with our supply chain. Importantly, our capital allocation policy is unchanged. We absolutely prioritize retaining that strong balance sheet. That's very important for us to grow the business, to deliver our strategy. It's important to allow us to invest in the business, to invest in the adjacent market strategy, which I'll come on to in a moment, to look for bolt-on acquisitions where they are supportive and can accelerate our strategy. And of course, it provides protection in the event of any market downturn. And we're not seeing that in our markets at the moment. The strong balance sheet allows us then to prioritize dividends for our shareholders. And our dividend policy is that we'll pay a dividend twice covered by earnings. So 50p in the pound return to our dividend to our shareholders. And we've also said that we'll return any excess cash when appropriate to shareholders. So you put that together for the year ended June 2022, our dividend increased 70% to 8p. Our dividend covered two times as we set out. And we've also initiated a £15 million share buyback. And so that will be very earnings accretive as we go through the process of that buyback, which we started on the 21st of September. So with that backdrop of what we've delivered in the year just finished, what I now want to do is just talk about our strategy and how we go forward, how that strong culture and approach allows us to continue to improve and to grow the business. And of course, that's the essence of the investment case. So this is a very simple, straightforward overview of our strategy. Our strategy is to deliver high quality buildings and infrastructure in a socially responsible way, and to do that in a way which provides a sustainable return for our shareholders. And there's really four pillars on here that you can see. So the first is focusing on our people, delivering a progressive culture, making sure we get the best talent wanting to work and wanting to develop their careers with Galliford Try. And of course, doing that in a way which ensures that everybody goes home safely each and every day. Secondly, is about socially responsible delivery. So this is about social value, working with our local communities, local employment, local supply chain. It's about working in a way which addresses decarbonisation, biodiversity, water scarcity. And these are really important for the business. They're important because they are drivers for our clients, so they help us to win work. They're important for our people, so they help us to retain and recruit the best people. And of course, they're morally and socially the right things for us to be doing as well. We want to focus on quality and innovation to make sure we can deliver excellence for our clients. That's about digital investment. That's about investment in modern methods of construction. And of course, it's about investment working with the supply chain. And I've already mentioned that we pay our supply chain promptly. And we've got a program where we try to, for our key 350 suppliers are on our aligned supply chain, where we work very closely with them. They have access to our pipeline, to our training and so on. So we can make sure that we bring our supply chain along with us. And this year we've introduced, for example, our Net Zero Partners program, where we're helping our supply chain work on that decarbonisation journey and bring them with us on the decarbonisation agenda. And if we get those things right, then we will deliver sustainable, predictable financial returns for our shareholders, which of course is important for all of us. So this slide really shows us how we're going to deliver that. So the objective is sensible, controlled revenue growth, but more importantly, focus on margin growth. So we've set out our targets to 2026, growing the business to £1.6 billion revenue and 3% margin target. But of those, the absolute key target is the 3% margin. It's about the quality of the earnings, the quality of the projects that we are taking on, which is so important. So this schematic is intended to just show how we're going to grow the business. So we set the strategy up in 2021, which is the left-hand side. We've just reported the middle section, and we're looking to get to the 2026 targets. And we'll do that by growing in our existing markets, so our existing building business, which operates in schools, in healthcare, in justice, in defence, building social infrastructure across the UK. And there's opportunity for us to grow in those existing markets. In infrastructure, we operate in water and in highways. And again, both of those markets have great opportunity for us to grow. The highways business, we've got a great pipeline of work coming through the RIS program with National Highways and through local authority programs. And in water, there's increasing investment in water, clean water, wastewater treatment works. So we see our existing markets are able to grow in the current environment. And on top of that, we're looking to grow in three, what we call adjacent markets. So these are markets that we know well, we understand, but they're opportunities for us to grow in higher margin parts of the market. So the first of those is in the private rented sector, PRS, where we already construct a number of private rented schemes each year. And we're looking to move into the development phase to source the land, to do the development, get the various planning consents, and then do the construction for our clients as we always have done. And we see that's when you look across the pieces, substantially increases the margin for us of those PRS schemes. We have a facilities management business, which operates and maintains buildings. And we see the opportunity to move that into what we call the green retrofit market. So this is proactively going to buildings, surveying them to understand what interventions you can make on an existing building to improve its carbon efficiency, to lower its energy costs. And of course, that's particularly valuable at the moment, given where energy prices are. And we see this as a really, particularly in the public sector, schools, hospitals and so on, as a real opportunity to make a big difference in terms of lowering the energy costs and the carbon footprint of those buildings. And in the water sector, we're very experienced at designing and building and commissioning water and wastewater treatment works. And we're now looking to move into the maintenance and optimization of those treatment works, which again is a higher margin part of the sector. And we developed some capabilities in this space when we did the acquisition in October 2021 of the water business of NMCN. So we see good opportunities to grow the business, and in particular to grow the business in a way which targets margin growth over the next 4 years. The market outlook is very, very resilient at the moment, and the market is there to support the growth that I've just referred to. So notwithstanding the current political uncertainties, there is a wave of opportunities. There's a huge pipeline of work. We turn away a huge amount of work at the moment. And the important point is that we don't operate in a cyclical sector. We operate in a sector which works in very long-term horizons. We're building schemes which might have a long gestation period and might be on ground for 18, 24 months. So there's a long, resilient outlook in terms of the sectors that we work in. And when you think about the sectors, schools, the demographics and the age and state of the school estate means that there needs to be continued investment in that space. Similarly with living accommodation in the defence space. Similarly, we've talked about the water and wastewater treatment works continue to need investment. And those are driven by the regulatory environment rather than, short-term economic criteria. And similarly, in highways, the highways funding for the schemes that we're looking to deliver is already in place and is already there with National Highways. So we see a strong market and very resilient to what we're trying to achieve. Importantly, the focus as we approach that market, as I started on, is all about risk. Risk is embedded in what we do, and making sure we've got that culture of risk awareness in our tendering process, in the contracts, is so important. So we focus and address the market with a real lens of risk management. And most of our work is now awarded on a split of quality and price, where quality is the most important component, maybe 80-20 or 70-30, balanced in favor of quality rather than financial metrics. And quality is the quality of our people, the quality of our track record, the quality of our sustainability or social value credentials and so on. And so it's possible now for us to win not being the cheapest. And in fact, a tender opportunity where it's lowest price wins is something which would be a real red flag for us, because that drives all the wrong behaviors. And we go to market based on quality in the first instance. That's a very mature way for the for our clients to procure, and it aligns very closely with our own risk management strategy. And what that leads to when you put all of that together is a really, really high quality order book, £3.4 billion. That gives me 90% visibility for this year. It gives me about 65% visibility for next financial year, and probably about 30% visibility for the financial year after that. So I've got a really long line of sight. But more importantly, every single project in that order book is the kind of project that we can deliver day in, day out. It's all got the right risk profile. It's all got the right terms and conditions. It's all got the right technical capabilities. So that's really important. That means that that order book supports the margin aspirations that we have as a business. You can see that order book on the right-hand side there. 94% of that is with repeat clients, and 90% of it is secured through frameworks. And these frameworks give me long-term visibility of the future pipeline. They give me established terms and conditions to work on. And importantly, in our building business, the median contract is less than £20 million. And what that means is there's no individual contract in that order book that, if it were to turn down, would have the potential to undermine all the good work on all the other projects. So we've got a real balanced portfolio of projects which we can deliver across the piece. We continue to have that order book largely in the public and regulated sectors, and we see those sectors continuing to invest for all the reasons which I've talked about earlier on. So to bring all that together, Sarah, we've had a really good performance in the year through to June 2022. We've got a really robust and confident outlook for the current financial year and for our strategy through to 2026, and we're on track with those financial targets. Probably in terms of the margin, we're probably slightly ahead of the trajectory through to 2026. And importantly, if we achieve the margin targets and the revenue targets, then our PBT will just about double from the PBT that we've posted in the year to June 2022. And of course, the dividend will increase to match that. So we're very confident in the future. We've got a really good business. Importantly, it's grounded on culture. It's grounded on really excellent people, client relationships, supply chain relationships. And that's what gives us the confidence as we move forward. And so, Sarah, I was going to leave the presentation there, and then we can take Q&A.
And it's all about people, people, people. Right at the beginning, you said you talked to us about the risk awareness, which is homogenous across the company. You're making sure that everybody gets home safe. You look after people across the board. Suppliers get paid within 25 days, which you're setting a bit of a gold standard there for the industry. And I'm not sure if you've mentioned this, but a one-off payment to all employees to cope with the cost of living challenge. And you're not one of the cheapest, but the order book is robust, so you're loved by your clients.
It's really important. So, Sarah, we do obviously regular employee surveys. During COVID, we did those just as well, just of site-based stuff. So the staff who had to go out of the home, you know, to make sure that they were feeling supported. We have an advocacy score of the business about 84%. We've got about 94% of our staff buy into the strategy and buy into the vision that we have for the company. And you're right, we try to look after our people, whether that be around mental health and well-being sessions that we do across the business, and invite families and partners and so on to join that as well. The cost of living payment, we gave it to about half our people, about 1,800 people. We targeted it to the lower paid, and that cost the business £1 million. It's the right thing to do to help people. It's in the current circumstances. We've just introduced this week, actually, to celebrate Menopause Day, our first menopause policy. So we're really focusing on making sure that we're a business which is very progressive and a business where people want to work, because we want to attract and develop the best talent in the industry.
So here's me talking about the order book. The forward-looking order book is robust. Michael Conway wants to know about the best projects just gone. He says, an impressive set of results. What was the most profitable project you worked on last year?
So all of our projects were profitable. So what we do, Michael, is we track all of our projects, of course, in compared to expectations, so compared to the tender, compared to the budget on individual jobs. And when you track those on a kind of scatter graph, it's actually a really narrow band, which is exactly where we want it to be. So most of our jobs are performing where we would expect them to be. We have some outperformers. We have, you know, a few which drop below that trend line. None of the ones below are material. Yeah, they typically kind of outweigh the ones which are above. So we have a whole mix. I mean, I'm not going to name an individual project, but importantly, you know, what we have is across that portfolio. Yeah, I think the portfolio approach to our contracts is helps drive that certainty and that predictability of performance, which we're starting to generate that track record of doing what we said we'd do as a business.
So in terms of that business, I'm looking across the business. You've got building, highways, environment. Ian Clegg asks, what is the set of criteria that you use to decide whether to take on a contract or not?
That's a really good question, because that, and you know, that goes back to the heart. If you take the right contracts, then you give yourself a great chance. If you take the wrong contracts, then of course you're on the back foot. So that contract selectivity is absolutely front and center. So first and foremost, we don't take any big fixed price or risk lump sum kind of infrastructure projects, the kind of things, you know, which in the past have got companies into trouble. So in our infrastructure business, everything that we do in infrastructure, so highways and water, is on a target cost reimbursable basis. So very good form of contracting. It aligns the incentives for the client and the contractor, which is great. So it means people work together, you know, to find solutions. But all of our jobs, Ian, go through what we call a bidding heat map. So the heat map has a whole series of risk criteria, from who's the client, have we worked with them before, what's their payment profile like, you know, what's the geography of the job, what's the technical challenges, you know, what's the terms and conditions, have we got the people, is that particular region already overstretched or understretched, a whole raft of criteria, as well as size. And if any of those criteria are red, then that job will come to the executive board for approval. So even if it's a, you know, real straightforward, simple, small job, but the geography's wrong, or you know, then that would come to the executive board for approval, along with, by the way, every job over £25 million in any event. And so we have this really holistic way of looking at risk and looking at contract selectivity. It's not just about, you know, size is a factor, but it's not the only risk factor. So we have this holistic approach to looking at risk. But I think for me, the really interesting thing is we've had that process in place now probably 4 or 5 years. So everything in the order book's come through that heat map process. And what's really interesting now is that our local regional managing directors are completely aligned in terms of culturally and risk appetite and what we're looking to do. So they don't, you know, those projects don't come to the executive board for us to say no. The local business has the same outlook, so they will have already turned these things down. You know, and clearly, you know, we get some coming across our desk, but nowhere near as many as we did a few years ago, because there's such an alignment of interest. And you know, all of the business has got the same incentives as myself and the chief executive. It's about profit and it's about cash and about ESG. There's nobody in the business who's incentivized on turnover. So these things all drive the right behavior. But that heat map, Ian, is absolutely kind of front and center in terms of that risk management process.
How defensive is your business strategy? Because I didn't sense any fear when you referenced the economic climate. I mean, since you and I last spoke, I feel as though we've entered times of austerity. So is your business relatively agnostic in times of as we're experiencing now?
I don't want to come across as complacent or blasé. We spend a huge amount of time monitoring the market. So, but the couple of things I'd say. So first of all, you know, we have 90% of this year's work in hand when we started the financial year, 65% next year. So that gives us a good platform, a long-term line of sight. So we're not out chomping at the bit for jobs today to start tomorrow. That's not, yeah, that doesn't, that's not the business model. The model is a much longer term play. Parts of the sector, so water, for example, you know, there's a huge pressures in the water sector at the moment, but those come from the regulator. You know, those are regulatory pressures, and the regulator is not going to stop the requirement for water companies to continue to invest in improving clean water and wastewater treatment work. So we see some good fundamentals which will drive that behavior. As I say, if you look in education, the demographics demand, you know, that we have, you know, that we continue to build schools and that we continue to replace, you know, the schools which need replacement. So of course, you know, there may be some short-term challenges, but typically, you know, the long-term frameworks and that long-term line of sight gives us a really good opportunity to plan the business. And of course, it's the same with our supply chain. Of course, again, we're very conscious to make sure that we are staying very close to our supply chain and making sure that they also are robust and resilient in the current climate as well. So you know, we're not immune to the world we operate in, clearly, but this is not a kind of front cyclical sector. In that sense, it's, you know, it is a relatively defensive sector.
I'm just thinking about the potential opportunities that may emerge due to distressed asset sales, good businesses, but unfortunately they've fallen in hard times. You have made, I think it's two acquisitions over the last 12 months. One of them was for a pound. So I'm just wondering, more acquisitions to come, and will there be more than a pound?
So possibly is the answer to both questions. So look, our strategy does not require us to do acquisitions. So we're not, we don't have targets there which are dependent on something outside of our control. But we're very alive to the opportunity for bolt-on acquisitions, particularly in that adjacent market space, which can accelerate the strategy, that can add capabilities to the business and be margin enhancing for the business. So the two acquisitions that we've done have been excellent, both in the water sector. So NMCN gave us both geographic infill, but also additional capabilities in capital maintenance part of the market. And so post that acquisition, we now work for all the major water companies across the UK. And then that capital maintenance part of that business also came with an asset optimization, a factory which builds chemical dosing plants and water treatment control panels. And the second acquisition we did for a pound in July is another factory which builds, again, those motor control sensors for the water industry. So that's starting to give us a real critical mass in terms of that offsite manufacturing capability and that capability for improving the asset optimization in the water sector. So we'll continue to look for bolt-on opportunities which align to our strategy. They may be, for a pound, they may be for more than a pound, but that, importantly, the strategy doesn't require us to make acquisitions in order to hit those targets.
So in the next 6 months or so, let me see. So your year end is June, so you've got at least another 9 months to enjoy. So what's going to be happening over the next 9 months then?
Well, look, we're very well set. So we've got, obviously, our half years will be out in March, and then the full years will be out in through to June. So we're very well set for this year. Yeah, we'll continue to invest in our people, to continue to invest in graduates. We're taking more graduates, more apprentices, more trainees this year than ever before. And that's really important. That brings through our own pipeline of talent. It's generally a more diverse intake than the rest of the business, which is great. We've got, a negative gender pay gap for our early careers, which is great. So we're starting to continue to invest in our people. We'll continue to invest in our digital assets, our digital capabilities. That's about quality, it's about efficiency, it's about getting things right first time. And we'll continue to invest in our low carbon credentials. That's a real driver of opportunity, particularly for people like the Department for Education. If you can't build schools with a low carbon footprint, then you can't build schools for the Department for Education. So we'll continue to push hard on that agenda, which is really important, as I said earlier, for our clients and for our people, as well as being the right thing to do. So it's more of the same, Sarah, and it's really delivering and being focused on the strategy that you can see on the slide there to make sure that we continue to deliver predictable results. And that's what we're all about, doing what we said we're going to do.
More of the same. Now, you'd normally associate that with boredom, but not at all. In your case, it's just continuing to strive to do your utmost best. Thank you very much indeed. And yeah, that the most recent results are testimony to all those efforts. Really appreciate your time. Thank you very much indeed, Andrew. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, Sarah. Take care.